Thank you, Anselm. I want to join my fellow speakers in thanking Anselm, Paz, and the whole team of the HKW for having me here. And I'm actually quite excited to, because this is my first public foray into the world of Carl Einstein scholarship. I'm not an expert. I'm coming from a little bit from the sidelines, but I've always been passionate about this writer and thinker, and I was super glad when Anselm asked me if I would be interested in joining him, collaborating with him in preparing and actually realizing this project, which is scheduled for the late 2017. In October 2015, The Exalted, a new one-hour performance written by playwright, poet, singer, essayist, theater director, etc., Carl Hancock Rux, and directed by Anne Bogart, premiered at the BAM Next Wave Festival in New York. Beautiful, enigmatic, and almost entirely opaque, a New York Times critic writes about the event, The Exalted centers on Carl Einstein, a German Jewish art historian who killed himself while trying to escape occupied France in 1940. Carl Hancock Rux, the review continues, dressed in a cap, suspenders, and baggy breeches, narrates the end of Einstein's life as the avant-garde composer Theo Blackman acts out his final moments. Einstein's final moments. There are also excerpts from Einstein's lectures on African art. There haven't been lectures on African art by Einstein, if it's to my knowledge. Songs created live with the sound of Mr. The reviewer is referring to books or text essays Einstein wrote on African art. Songs created live with the sound of Mr. Blackman's own breath. A brief summary of the Namibian genocide by German troops in the early 20th century, some ancillary video, and a charming rendition of Lili Marleen. However, in the critic's eye, these aspects never cohere, nor does the incoherence seem especially purposeful or illuminating. The suffering of individuals and states and the unexpected revelation of beauty might be the governing themes. They might not. The performance seems the sort of thing that is perfectly intelligible to those involved, but baffling to anyone less in the know. Several times the review ends, Mr. Rux repeats a quotation from Einstein describing the act of making art as a blend of cruelty and assassination. Maybe so, but here at least it includes a hefty portion of perplexity too, end of quote. To readers of Carl Einstein's writings, this review may sound, and the kind of tone of the review may sound somewhat familiar. Perplexity certainly is one mode of reaction easily elicited by Einstein's rapid-fire, often repetitious, highly condensed, packed, neologistic, opinionated essays, articles, poems, plays, and books. To base a performance on Einstein's biography and intellectual production can hardly prevent to become a super dense and therefore potentially opaque affair. As already intimated in the New York Times review, Einstein led a tumultuous, even desperate and ultimately tragic life. A young Jewish poet close to the German expressionist movement around the journal Die Aktion in the pre-First World War years, who by the age of 27 published his novel Bebouquin oder Die Dilettanten des Wunders in 1912. He survived the war, worked in the colonial department of the Brussels Civil Administration, where he had access to the library of the infamous Africa Museum in Tervuren, became active in the Soldiers' Council in Belgium in 1918, returned to Germany to join the November Revolution and the Spartakusbund, held a speech at Rosa Luxemburg's funeral in June 1919, collaborated with Wieland Herzfelde, George Gross, Paul Westheim, Alfred Flechtheim, and others in numerous publishing endeavors, caused a scandal with his blasphemous theater piece, Die Schlimme Botschaft, authored the last volume of the legendary 24-volume Propyläen Kunstgeschichte on the art of the 20th century, Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts, the first edition of which was published in 1926, moved from Berlin to Paris in 1928, where he founded in 1929, together with Georges Bataille and Georges Wildenstein, the surrealist magazine Document, Doctrine, Archaeologie, Beaux-Arts, Ethnographie, wrote a complex monograph on Georges Braque, who was also his best man in his, at his wedding in 1934, I think, that was published in French in the same year, 1934, went with his wife, Luda Gouffrikian, to Spain in 1936 to join the anarcho-syndicalist CNT-FAI, the Confederación Nacional del Trabajo, Federación Anarquista Ibérica, and the Grupo Internacional of the Ratti Column at the Aragon Front of the Civil War, where he was soon elected Técnico de Guerra. In 1939, Einstein returned to France, where he was detained as a German citizen, escaped the German occupation of Paris during the fall of France, and fled to the south, where he was left trapped on the French border with Franco-Spain. On July 5, 1940, Einstein committed suicide in the Pyrenees town of L'Estel-Bétarram. Particularly interested in the circumstances of Einstein's death that was arguably caused by the loss of any possibility to belong to a nation or a nation state, by a stateless existence with all the life-threatening dangers this implies, Carl Hancock Rux capitalizes on the complexities of this intellectual's and activist's biography, as well as the very complexities that Einstein's ventures into African art and European modernism, into ethnography and psychology, provide for Rux's poetic political project. In Rux's own words, The Exalted sets out to untangle, I quote, knots of heritage, art, and atrocity to reconsider the price of freedom and self-preservation. The photograph promoting the evening shows Rux and Blackman standing opposite to each other while facing the camera with questioning, or if you will, self-asserting gazes. Blackman, who among other roles plays the character of Carl Einstein in the piece, holds a mask, probably of African origin, but who knows, it could also be produced somewhere else, only meant to look like an African mask. He holds the mask in a way as if he wants to latch it onto the face of its authors, Carl Hancock Rux, a gesture that seems to be about forcing an identity onto someone, as if to emphasize the Africanness of the African-American artist, who is in fact partly of German origin, as his grand-grandfather was German, hence the name Karl, hence Rux's interest in Afro-Germanness, hence his interest in the history of Germany's relation to Africa, to Germany's colonialist past and present, and to German culture's conceptions of African culture, and hence his longtime interest in the figure of the other Karl, Carl Einstein. In the performance's thematic context, the obvious reference of the mask gesture is Einstein's slim 1915 volume Negerplastik, the cover of which is conspicuously featuring a mask, as well as Einstein's continuing interest in African art and culture and the pursuit of a revisionist ethnographic account of art and primitivism throughout his work. In the course of The Exalted, Rux and Blackman act and read in front of projected translations from Einstein's text. Here you see the two standing with their back to a quote from the first page of Negerplastik, where Einstein, in his typical sharp-edged polemical prose, positions himself against the racist and colonialist denigrating attitude towards African art based on, quote, vague evolutionary hypothesis and a spurious concept of the primitive, recht vagen Evolutionshypothesen und einem Fehlbegriff von Primitivität. In the final chapter of the book, Einstein develops a short theory of the masks as an instrument of depersonalization and metamorphosis. Other than the psychologizing and at the same time theatrical European, the African in Einstein's terms, is prepared to transform him or herself, particularly in states of trance and ecstasy. Through the mask, a metamorphosis can take place, the abandoning of subjectivity in favor of an incarnation of the objective. Therefore, Einstein writes, the mask only makes sense when it is inhuman, non-personal, that is, constructive, free of the experiences of the individual. The fixedness or rigidity, the stupor of the African face masks is, I quote, nothing else than the final intensity of expression freed freed from any psychological becoming, with a tendency towards an ambivalent indifference of the psychological expression, fusing the physiognomic expressions of contradictory sensations. To a certain extent, Carl Hancock Rux and Theo Blackman demonstrate or test the validity of these claims. Somewhat undecided, they seem to ponder if the mask should be put on or not, whether it is ultimately stabilizing, fixing, or destabilizing, unfixing identity and personality. Bringing Carl Einstein to the stage in a performance written by a contemporary artist working quite deliberately on issues of African-American and Afro-German identity in an attempt to engage with multiple entangled histories and traumata in the present-day context of increased racism as well as anti-racist campaigns such as Black Lives Matter, both activates and actualizes Einstein's biography and writing. Furthermore, it participates in a process of canonization. For without a doubt, Einstein has become a sort of canonical figure during the past decade or so, even if he is still known by only a few initiated. By now, he is in some areas or some realms of academia at least, is being ranked regularly among other heroes of early 20th century European intellectual history, such as Walter Benjamin, Sigurd Karkauer, Abi Warburg, or Rudolf Arnheim. Though the rediscovery of Einstein began in West Germany in the 1960s and 1970s with important research and editorial work done by Sibylle Penkert and Heidemarie Oehm, the founding of the Carl Einstein Gesellschaft in 1984, the philological work by Liliane Meffre or Klaus H. Kiefer, and last not least by the addition of Einstein's collected writings, by now comprising 5 volumes between 1980 and 1996, provided a fairly comprehensive scholarly apparatus around the work. The breakthrough, particularly on an international level, had to wait until the 2000s, when October in 2004 published an issue dedicated to Einstein, when Uwe Fleckner presented his monumental monograph in 2006, followed by an exhibition on Einstein Fleckner curated at the Reina Sofia in Madrid in 2008 and 9, accompanied by a catalog in Spanish and English. When David Quigley, in the same year, 2006, published his dissertation, Carl Einstein, A Defense of the Real. When in 2011, the Musée de Quai Branly published an anthology on Carl Einstein et le primitivisme. And when just recently, Sebastian Zeitler collected his long-standing research on Einstein into the 2016 form as Revolt. The growing interest in Einstein's multi-scalar transdisciplinary practice, however, shall interest me here mainly as a contemporary context or scholarly framework that navigates, organizes, and affects the ongoing encounters with a work that in itself displays a highly peculiar, ambivalent relationship to the very acts and politics of canonization. In his lifetime, Einstein was considered a difficult, redundant, flamboyant, anti-didactic, and polarizing theorist of art, someone whose authority was based not only on his apparent knowledge and erudition, but even more on his reputation of being relentless, incomprehensible at times, obscure and daring, that is, not at all academic and disciplined. Nonetheless, he was commissioned in 1922 by Propyläen Kunstverlag, an imprint of the Berlin publisher Ullstein, to conceive and to write the canonical book in German language on contemporary art. The Propyläen History of Art project, published in 24 volumes between 1923 and 1944, here 17 of those volumes, arguably embodied the canon, the canonical, like hardly any other publishing endeavor on the arts at the time. It was understood as the key authoritative compendium of knowledge on world art history, written by leading and institutionally embedded protagonists from the German museum and university field, such as Wilhelm von Bode, Gustav Pauli, or Max Friedländer. The volumes not only were conceived as interventions in the various subdisciplines of museology, art history, Renaissance studies, design history, Kunstwissenschaft, aesthetics, etc., but also as guidebooks for potential art buyers and collectors, and this not only nationally. For instance, an article in the Chicago Sunday Time Tribune from January 1931 claimed that noted contemporary art collectors have based their collections on the theories they found in Einstein's Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts, which you see here. However, the same article emphasizes that Einstein, while his opinion is sought by dealers and connoisseurs in all the countries of Europe, has always remained strictly aloof from anything even remotely resembling commercial exploitation of his expert knowledge. So much about the economics of canon production and the individual strategies to resist their seductions. By choosing Einstein, Propylaen and Ullstein had obviously looked for a writer that would be able to compete on a par with the most discussed theorists of modern and contemporary art in German language, such as Julius Meyer-Graefe and Wilhelm Hausenstein. Meyer-Graefe's Entwicklungsgeschichte der modernen Kunst, published in three volumes for the first time in 1904, and two volumes for the first time in 1904, saw three more editions until 1924, the last one in three volumes. Addressed at the Lichtmenschen, the light or enlightened people of the early 20th century, it defined Impressionism as the ultimate peak in modern art's development, equated it with modern art per se, and historicized it. By constructing an evolutionary and competitive Darwinist and anti-academic history of Impressionism as a specific artistic mode operating amidst the history of the visual arts as such, Meyer-Graefe's teleological model indeed aspired to become a canon architecture. He even used architectonic metaphors such as the one of the four pillars of modern art, die vier Säulen der modernen Malerei, Manet, Renoir, Degas, and Cézanne. The influence of Meyer-Graefe's writings and his evolutionary historicist model on the 1906 centennial exhibition of German art, Deutsche Jahrhundertausstellung, the Deutsche Jahrhundertausstellung, by the way, designed the publications and the exhibition design by Peter Behrens, which completely revised the history of 19th century painting and become one of the most canonical events in European early 20th century modernism, cannot be underestimated and was a sort of touchstone of every canonizing endeavor that would follow it in the 20th century. However, Meyer-Graefe's evolutionary model of the rise and decline of the impressionistic mode proved to be inappropriate when it came to take into account the avant-garde ruptures before, during, and after the First World War. The canonicity of his model that was based on a pessimistic view of the state of contemporary art and culture failed in the face of the epistemological breaks entailed by expressionism, cubism, dada, etc. Like Meyer-Graefe and Einstein, Wilhelm Hausenstein worked as a freelance writer. Interestingly, all three never occupied official positions in the institutions of the art world or the academy. Moreover, all three practiced as literary writers. The production of the canon of modern art, it seems, had to happen in the often precarious, dubious independence of the free agent competing on the publishing and art markets. Like Einstein, who was 2 years his junior, Hausenstein belonged to the post-Meyer-Graefe generation, had a strong interest in non-European arts. He wrote a rather favorable review of Einstein's Negerplastik in 1915, and became an ardent partisan of expressionism, which for him was the epitome of zeitgenössische Kunst, contemporary art. Hausenstein was a popular, widely read counterpart for Einstein and his theory of art, who emphatically, as the titles of his 1914 Die bildende Kunst der Gegenwart, Contemporary Visual Art, and his 1920 Die Kunst in diesem Augenblick, The Art of This Very Moment, already suggest, tried to be off and in the now of contemporary art production. Originally asked to organize his contribution around the most recent art, die jüngste Kunst, Expressionism, as it reads in the first draft contract with Propylaen Ullstein, Einstein embarked between 1922 and 1926 on a research and writing process that would lead him to encompass the various European modernist tendencies following Impressionism, focusing on painting and here namely on Cubism and German Expressionism. The roughly 170 print pages of text of the first edition, published in 1926, were followed by almost 400 pages of illustrations, the most comprehensive collection of reproductions of early 20th century painting and sculpture available at the time. Only L. Lisitsky's and Jean Arp's slim 1925 Die Kunstismen may be compared with Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts in its ambition, though certainly not in its scope and scale. The sheer physical weight of the book was even used as a weapon against its author when the sculptor Ernesto de Fiori, who felt grossly misrepresented by Einstein, hit the critic on his head in 1926 with the volume, an attack that caused quite a buzz in the Berlin papers of the time. Indeed, in his critical appraisals, Einstein did not take any prisoners. The judgments on his contemporaries, among them many close friends like George Grosz or Di Fiori, but also artists such as Kandinsky or Beckmann, are often cruel and unforgiving. The abrasive, harsh manner may and should be seen as a result of the urgency that Einstein sought after in the objects of his scrutiny. He quickly gets impatient with any artistic practice that doesn't commit itself to the radical overhaul of the ways in which pictures are being made and looked at, that doesn't work towards an extension and reconfiguration, a recomposition of the senses themselves in accordance with and in response to the continuous mechanization and industrialization of perception in capitalist and communist societies. Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts saw two further editions, both of which, particularly the third one and third and last one from 1931, were strongly revised by Einstein. He considerably extended the sections on Cubism and added a section on Surrealism, which he called Romanticism, as well as on Paul Klee, and included a lot of new plates and illustrations of works produced between 1926 and 1931, most importantly by Picasso, Braque, Léger, Klee, Miró, and André Masson, which would define his pillars or his canon, whose Masson's automatic drawings assumed an emblematic function for Einstein's conceptions of the very assassination and cruelty quoted by Carl Hancock Rux in The Exalted. To provide an idea of the sense of urgency that Einstein makes tangible in this book that oozes authority in very different registers, I propose to compare the first page of the introductions in the 1926 and 1931 editions, an introduction that Einstein titled Vorbedingungen, Preconditions. In these brief accounts of the disruption of the classicist academic order of 19th century naturalism and impressionism, the insurgency against the schematic, modulary approach to painting, against epiconism, against the usual image fabrication, die übliche Bilderfabrikation, was called revolt. Here, Revolte. In the 26 edition, whereas he changed the term to Aufruhr, turmoil, or upheaval in the 1931 edition. This edit may be read as a slight nuance shift from a political to a psychological semantics. It would thus parallel the changes at the beginning of the first paragraph, where Einstein in the 26 edition speaks of the new painterly experiences, the neue malerischen Erfahrungen und Erlebnissen here, that caused the breakdown of the academic beauty industry, whereas in the 1931 edition he uses the expression other or hidden experiences, anderen oder verborgenen Erfahrungen, thereby cutting the new and the painterly in order to direct the attention towards a deeper psychological or anthropological dimension that he held responsible for the crisis of the old system. Thusly adjusting, fine-tuning, and ultimately changing his argument within a time span of 5 years, Einstein also performs his canonizing project, which is anyway based on assumptions of the anti-canonicity of any relevant artistic practice, as a project of constant modification and modulation in an asymptotic argumentative movement towards ever higher degrees of analytic precision and description with regard to the role that art is supposed to play in a social, economic, political, and collective psychological situation which inevitably veers towards collapse. The publisher, on his part, advertised the new editions by emphasizing the book's importance as the major source of names and images. At the occasion of the second 1928 edition, the Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts is hailed as the first ever attempt to bring clarity in the chaos of the art of our time, to distinguish the valuable from the valueless, while using Paul Klee's 25, Die Erfinderin des Nests, the inventress of the nest, as visual evidence. The copytext of the 1931 ad is limited to a list of names and the assurance that the work is in fact leading right until our days. Almost every newly emerged artist's name of importance is to be found here, accompanied by a reason that is 1930 still life by Georges Braque. In many ways, these attempts at creating publicity ran counter to Einstein's intentions. Decidedly not pursuing a project of completeness or newness as such, simply filling in the gaps entailed by the course of time that passed between each edition with names, and also not searching any Apollinic clarity in the contemporary art's chaos, Einstein used the stage that the Populären Kunstgeschichte endeavor opened to him to place a Trojan horse before the public. The format of the encyclopedic handbook serves as the respectable ambience for a project of redefining, indeed recomposing, the ways in which the visual arts are being conceived and their historical meaning and immanent hierarchy of value and esteem narrated. For what Einstein proposes as an argument to be increasingly elaborated in the course of the three editions of Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts is a non-linear, trans-historical, and, using a term coined in his notes for a handbook of art from the 1930s, trans-visual conception of art. Most significantly developed in the years after he left Berlin for Paris in 1928 to escape the increasingly repressive atmosphere in Weimar Republic Berlin and to collaborate with Georges Bataille, Michel Leiris, and others on the Surrealist document endeavor, Einstein's theory of cubism and post-cubist tendencies, his ethnographic interests, and his rather devastating, self-depreciating analysis of intellectual culture and society at large in the late 20s and 30s converged into a bundle, into a cluster of arguments around the necessity to irrationalize art, to understand the most advanced practices such as Picasso's, Braque's, Masson's, or Klee's in the late 20s and early 30s as a new and free mythic way of looking, to acknowledge the collapse of subject-object divisions and the utmost importance of hallucination, the hallucinative aspect or hallucinative interval that disconnects the reality of the artwork from the external reality as well as the unconscious from the conscious, being as a new reign of the irrational and illogic in the making and the reception of art that has abandoned every representational relation and become the energetic force field of post-anthropomorphic recreation, and finally to admit to the inevitable process of primitivization that is due thanks to the failure of what Einstein called the liberal pluralism of realities. From Einstein's vantage point in the early 1930s, when he was revising Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts, preparing and writing his book on Georges Braque, and probably starting to work on the draft of Die Fabrikation der Fiktion, a furious attack on contemporary culture and an embittered exercise in self-cancellation, the technological and economic developments of the past decades have forever discredited the idea of the individual self of personality. The aktuelle Kunst, therefore, if it is actually to be qualified as contemporary, has to convey the hidden layers, the transpersonal and transhistorical energy fields, has to support and accelerate the crisis and the collapse of occidental subjectivity. Each hallucination, Einstein claims, by necessity is of a general collective order. It is in the dissociation, Abspaltung, that collective forces and forms are being aroused and used unconsciously and prophetically. The role of art in these processes, however, becomes increasingly problematic. As artworks turn out to be petrifications of experiences, they are conservative, notwithstanding their revolutionary gesture. This is Einstein in 1930 in France. And he was on a trip with Léger and a collector there. And some months later, on February 16, 1931, Einstein was invited by Karl Glaser to speak at the Berliner Staatliche Kunstbibliothek at Prinz Albrecht Street, today Niederkirchner Straße. The building of the Kunstbibliothek was next to the Martin Gropius Bau, and which is, as we all know today, the site of the Topography of Terror exhibition. In a series of six lectures entitled The Problems of Painting Today, Glaser, a prolific writer, historian, and curator, was the director of the rather progressive Kunstbibliothek and soon to be dismissed from his post by the Nazis. And probably aware of the fact that Einstein's heavily revised third edition of Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts, which was due to appear later in the same year. In a short reviewing note on the lecture in the journal Weltkunst, maybe by Glaser himself, Einstein is portrayed as a lecturer who keeps steady contact with the audience that in turn was vividly taking position against and in favor of the ideas he put forward. The draft of the talk has survived in the Einstein archive at the Akademie der Künste here in Berlin. It is an astonishingly accessible text surveying his theory at exactly this crucial turning point around, say, 28 and 32. In an important moment of the lecture, Einstein speaks of the dreams as being as disconnected from the daily life as are the hallucinations from which the pictures by Masson, Arp, Miró, Picasso, Klee, and others have emerged that he will be showing at a later stage of the talk. A state of trance is to be sought that in turn necessitates the erasure of any memory of the factual in order to pave the way into an inner world. After a long reflection on the force of symbols in primitive rituals and the urge to distance oneself from the external objects in trance and ecstasy, he dwells on the position of the human in the new art, which is one of passive affection, of sheer instrumentality, of submission to hallucination, like in archaic rituals, until the point where the I, the ego, is extinguished. Since pictures, and Einstein speaks of Bilder, not of paintings, are psychic compressions, seelische Stauung, that operate by reducing the relation to reality, not by affirming it. Towards the end of the 1931 Berlin lecture, Einstein asks himself and the audience why, considering this, the dissociations, extinctions, and cutoffs between subject and object, inner and outer reality, which are characteristic of the new art that he is promoting, it is still possible at all to relate to the pictures he has shown slides of, many of which probably of the order of this 1930 Masson, which he included in the 1931 edition of Die Kunst des 20. Jahrhunderts. His answer: Because they are projections of our own bodies, the various parts of which are being allocated according to symbolic accents. The psychographic processes in the automatic drawings of Masson thus are comparable with the primitive projection of a human being into a totem, like the tribal primitive artwork is conceived of in the cult ritual as a living corpse. Einstein informed the audience at the Kunstbibliothek, the recent pictures by Masson, Klee, Miró, or Picasso are to be understood as the vessels of our dead energies and hallucinations. Finally, he released the audience with another intriguing question. He asked, where do these pictures end? That is, where do they find their limit time, their Grenzzeit? The totality of images, Bildtotalität, Einstein said, he believes is only a symptom of exhaustion, and every intensification of sensation may ultimately result in a feeling of limits, in a Gefühl von Grenzen. The history of limits and the issue of canonicity could thus be radicalized and reoriented through Einstein's vision of a limit time, of the potential end of the very possibility of pictures in a world of mechanized, or today algorithmized, experience, of a utopian pessimism whose tectonics, as Einstein would say, will certainly not guarantee any solace from fear of death. And as Carl Hancock Rux eloquently elaborates in his performance on Einstein's deprivation of citizenship, the nationless dystopia of exile in the 1930s and 40s, where belonging for so many was suspended, not only Einstein's counter-canonical work lost its grounding, as it was bereft of any context based on a shared language, moreover, the hope to be absorbed as the lone intellectual in the great social process of socialist redistribution died in the Spanish Civil War. The very base of livelihood simply vanished. The tectonics to keep death at bay did not hold. Nowhere to turn anymore. The very Europe that he tried to make his home. He, who had theorized the radicalization of imagination as hallucination, as ultimately suicidal, these are his words, killed himself. Thank you.
Tzu Nyen is, perhaps I may allow myself to say, his work in itself is interesting in terms of the systems of divisions. He shows equally in theaters, film theaters, festivals, Wiener Festwochen to Cannes, as well as in exhibitions. I was glad to have the chance to collaborate with him in recent biennales and other occasions, and he was here in Berlin on an invitation by the DAAD and State, about which we are very happy. And many years now, Tzu Nyen has been exploring in his particular trans-visual and trans perhaps narrative way, Malayan histories of liminality and origin. And I'd like to invite Tzu Nyen to the stage. T for tiger, T for Theodolite.
Hello, good evening. And before I start, just wanted to thank all the other speakers for the really interesting papers. Thanks as well to Anselm and Pass for inviting me, and of course to all of you for staying. So I will jump straight into it. The title of my talk today is quite simply T for Tiger. It's actually broken up into 10 sections, so I guess it will be easy for us to keep track of how long it is. Yeah. So section 1, Leaf. I thought it would be good to start with this particular image. This is a tree of life puppet known in Indonesia as the Kayon or Gunagan, and it appears at the beginning of a wayang kulit or shadow puppet theater performance, I guess much like the front curtain in a Western theater. The general design of this puppet, a tree within a leaf, functions to remind the audience that the whole is present in its part, which I think is an important point for me to make as well, because this presentation is structured essentially as a series of 10 fragments from the long histories or stories of man and tiger interactions in the Malayan world. And it's illustrated with images that I collected in the last few years of my research, as well as some images from recent works that I produced. But before I go on, I would like to draw your attention to the scene represented on the leaf itself, which is a confrontation between two iconic animals of the Indonesian world, the tiger and the water buffalo, or kerbau in Indonesian. The clash between these two animals were, in the 17th century, something that was ritually staged as a public spectacle by the Javanese courts of the state of Mataram. But what the tiger and the buffalo meant depended on who was looking. In the eyes of the court, the tiger was a rival power. It was the king of wilderness and the lord of chaos. The court rooted for the buffalo, which stood for the solid values of civilization. To the peasant, the buffalo was plow animal. It embodied the life-giving force of agriculture. The tiger was untamed nature. But I guess that to the peasant, the tiger must have also evoked the court, the apex predator, which consumes without producing. The meaning of the tiger in tiger-buffalo fights would shift again in the age of Dutch colonization. The tiger now, for court and peasant alike, would stand for the European. We see the shadows of some puppets caught on a screen. This is actually a detail from the set of a theater performance that some collaborators and I made in 2014 called 10,000 Tigers. The Indonesian and Malaysian name for shadow puppet theater is wayang kulit. Wayang refers to theater, but it also evokes the sense of ghost, shadow, or the imagination. Kulit means skin. And at one moment in the performance, the screen lifts to reveal the puppets carved from buffalo skin, traditionally with tools that were themselves made of buffalo horns. Then, at another moment in the performance, a projector turns on, using these puppets as support for a projected image, derived from an 1865 print of an original drawing titled Interrupted Road Survey in Singapore by the German artist Heinrich Leutermann. This drawing depicts a 1835 mission by the British in the Singaporean forest, a survey mission by the British in the Singaporean forest, which was disrupted by an encounter with the tiger. Within a decade, an all-out war between tigers and human would erupt, which led eventually to the extinction of tigers in Singapore. In this image, we see the opposition between the civilizing mission of the white colonial surveyor on the one hand and of wild, untamed nature on the other. But in the local animistic cosmology, tigers were thought to be related by blood to humans in the distant horizon of an ancestral past, which means that this opposition between man and tiger was not something that was indigenous to the local system of thought. For them, tigers were regarded as vehicles or mediums for ancestral spirit. So shamans actually in Malaya, in Indonesia, but also around in Southeast Asia, were thought to have the ability to transform into tigers. So this is in fact one of the few things which I think truly links this pluralistic region, which is Southeast Asia. We find this myth in the Philippines, in Thailand, for example, with Apichapong's film, Tropical Melody. We find this in Indonesia, in Malaysia. The dispersal of tigers across Southeast Asia took place more than a million years ago, long before the emergence of Homo sapiens. And when early human settlers first arrived in the region some 20,000 years ago, many of them favored as their habitat the transitory zone between the forest and the waters, an ecotone also occupied by other large ground-dwelling mammals like the deer and the boar, as well as the tiger that preyed upon these mammals. Humans did not yet have the capacity to dominate this savanna-like landscape, for which the tiger was so perfectly adapted. To live in such a terrain, humans had to attune themselves to the ways of the tiger, a process that brought about a kind of a fusion between the two species. What we have been looking at are actually video stills from Two or Three Tigers, which is an ongoing project that I began in 2015, featuring basically computer-generated figures or rigs that are animated by a human performer through motion capture processes. I guess they were kind of attempts to try to grow a kind of a were tiger with digital means. In parts of the Malay world, the tiger was believed to live in villages where the houses were said to be made of human skin and the roofs are thatched with human hair. So very often we find this focus, I think, on the skin, on the form as a container, a certain kind of separation between the body and the spirit. The first written record of the Malayan were tiger comes from an early 15th century Chinese source, the triumphant Visions of the Shores of the Ocean, which was written by a man called Ma Huan, who served as an interpreter to the great Ming Dynasty navigators and sailor, Admiral Cheng Ho, or Admiral Zheng He, during the Ming Dynasty. Of his visit to Malacca, Ma Huan wrote, "In the town, there are tigers which can assume human form. They enter the markets and walk about, mixing with the populace. If anyone recognized one of these creatures, he would seize it and kill it." It was said that a tiger can dissolve itself into human shape in the midst of crossing lakes and rivers, which makes me think of how Bataille once described very beautifully the being of an animal in the world as that of water in water. Water is, in Southeast Asia, the prime element. It features in almost all its myths of origin. It is a liminal element, a lubricant for metamorphosis, which facilitates all kinds of change of states from inanimate to the animate, from the void to life. It is said that should a body of water not be closed at hand for the would-be were-tiger, he could instead perform three somersaults, drawing in the air the sign of the swastika, which is also the symbol of water, the whirlpool, and the eternal return. Let's return now to 1835, to the interrupted road survey in Singapore. This particular survey of 1835 was undertaken in preparation for a new road to be cut through the forest to accommodate the increasing number of gambia and pepper plantations that were brought on by rising European demands. Both gambia and pepper are cash crops that were highly destructive, requiring huge amounts of timber to process. Gambia involved the constant boiling of the leaves, while pepper required kiln drying, and this resulted in the destruction of the surrounding forests for firewood. Some animal species, such as the wild boar, thrived in this new environment with the extra foraging opportunities that such plantations offered, and thus also thrived the tigers that fed on these wild boars. But some tigers, of course, also began developing a taste for domestic livestock, like dogs and sometimes human beings. Miraculously, it was reported that no humans were harmed in this 1835 encounter with the tiger. Only the theodolite, which is the toppling instrument in the center of the image, was reported to have been destroyed to bits. The theodolite was an instrument for the measuring of the angles of horizontal and vertical planes, so it was a necessary tool for the rationalization of space that Coleman was spearheading. Coleman, in any case, I wanted to introduce him next, because this particular theodolite had belonged to him, to the surveyor whose name was George Dromgo Coleman. Coleman was a highly accomplished civil architect and land reclaimer of Irish extraction. In 1833, Coleman was appointed both the superintendent of public works in Singapore, and he also became responsible, for example, for reclaiming large plots of land from the sea, from the river marshes, for extending the towns, and for designing many notable civic buildings in classic Palladian style, such as the St. Andrew Cathedral, which was the first church in Singapore. But Coleman was also at the same time the superintendent of convicts in Singapore, of the prison. So most of the convicts that Coleman had to deal with in his duty were Indians. They were responsible for crimes ranging from robbery, rape, riot, murder, to political sedition. These Indian convicts were sentenced to what was known as transportation, which essentially meant a term in an overseas prison in other parts of the British Empire. But this was really also a life of indentured labor. because convicts were employed in all aspects of public work. They were involved in the draining of the marshes, the building of the roads, and actually also in the survey departments where they served as chainmen, survey assistants, and land measurers, and that is where many of them also encountered tigers. It was precisely these Indian convicts that had made up Coleman's entourage in this survey of 1835. You see them sprawled around, scattered by the encounter. But it was also them who basically built all the buildings that Coleman had designed, including the first church in Singapore. In 1844, when brick, the prices of brick soared because of so much development, the colonial administration basically got the prisoners to even produce their own bricks to build the buildings with. In Singapore, in 1860, this is a story that I like very much, which is that these prisoners were assigned to the construction of a new building in the public square, and it was only when it was close to completion that they realized what they were building resembled a prison. You know, so they were basically building their own future prisons. But in any case, Coleman's twin duties of public works and the supervising of convicts conflated as a model of empire building that I would like to describe as Herculean, you know, in the sense that amongst Hercules' famous 12 labors were the very same symbols of economic development, the clearing of land, the draining of swamps, and the development of agriculture, as well as the domestication of livestock, the establishment of commerce, and also the introduction of technology. One of Hercules' most iconic mission was his second labor, the destruction of the Hydra of Lerna. When he lopped off one of the Hydra's heads, you know, two new ones grew in its place. As Linnabau and Radical noted, the Hydra in the European imagination stood for disorder and resistance, a powerful threat to the building of state, empire, and capitalism, and was often employed in parliament and in print as a metaphor for describing this difficulty of imposing order on an increasingly global system of labor. The life of one of these convicts could take the form of a kind of traveling without moving, because under confinement, they drifted across the Indian Ocean and circulated within Malaya. When Bencoolen, on the southwestern coast of Sumatra, was conceded to the Dutch by the London Treaty of 1825, 800 to 900 of these Indian convicts that were in a prison settlement there were distributed amongst the other three settlements, British settlements of Penang, Malacca, and Singapore. In Singapore, the prisoners were motivated by a system of reward and promotion, which meant eventually becoming warders over their own fellow prisoners before they were finally released into the colony as citizens. For many of the convicts, however, this was a journey of no return. The experience of this transportation was to be sent across what the Indians called the Kala Pani, or the black water, in which their former lives were to be dissolved forever, like water in water. The architecture of the prisons in colonial Singapore differed from the radial plan of the panoptic model that was kind of an ideal in Europe. Rather, the prisons in Singapore resembled the system of the dormitory, which, in other words, treated the prisoners as workers. And they were homogenized with their diet and also their labor regimes. Prisoners of all castes were mixed together, which the administrators considered an advantage and protection against all possible combined revolt, for it was their cynical belief that no one caste would invariably betray the other castes. So in this kind of convict shops where these convicts were put to work, the convicts thought of these shops as what they called the Jeta Junaza, or living tomb. These Indian prisoners of all castes were mixed so closely together that for a person of caste, it meant constant defilement and thus perpetual excommunication from his own kin. The Singaporean prison had a reputation for being progressive in the ways that it could put the convicts to work. It was basically the first Indian jail to introduce a steam-powered sawmill and pulp mill for manufacturing. A printing press was used in printing and bookbinding and published documents for various government departments. J.F.A. McNair, the Comptroller General of Convicts, wrote in his memoirs, 1899 memoirs, which also tellingly titled Prisoners, Their Own Warders. He wrote that upon learning photography in 1861, he taught photography to two literate convicts, whom he put to work in a specially constructed photographic studio inside the Singaporean jail, which provided services to Europeans who needed to take photos or portraits. But out of this studio was also produced a series of photographs of their fellow prisoners. Some of these photos, the original photos can't be found, so they only remain in McNair's memoirs. So basically, these pictures included various categories or types of convicts, from fifth class incorrigibles to first class overseers, timekeepers, and clerks. So basically, the Singaporean prison was had a certain kind of reputation for being progressive. So its aim was to eliminate the need for all external warders, so that basically the prisoner could survey themselves. So it was really the most efficient kind of system built in the true spirit, I guess, of British pragmatism. As Claire Anderson, the historian, noted, these photographs that were generated sort of unconsciously mirrored the ethnographic projects that were simultaneously underway in the Indian subcontinent as well as in British Malaya. In 1899, the English anthropologist Walter William Skeat entered deep into the forested heart of Malaysia. In 1906, he published his major text, which was called The Pagan Races of the Malay Peninsula, and it included in it the first photograph of a Malay were-tiger. So I've always been quite fascinated with this particular image. It's always apparently only one of the two men was a were-tiger. It was the person on the right, I guess, my right, which is your left. Yeah. So, but it's an interesting kind of a decision to have the two of them, as though there is something kind of like uncountable with this were-tiger. But in any case, by the 20th century, belief in the were-tigers have become relegated to the realm of folklore, following the widespread upheavals of landscape under British colonial rule, as well as the tiger extermination campaigns, for example, which was carried out in Singapore soon after Coleman's encounter with the tiger. Nevertheless, I think that tigers continue to exercise a great hold over the imagination of Southeast Asia. They continue to haunt the imaginary landscapes of this region. So what I'm going to do now is basically kind of a quick, succinct kind of tracking of the afterlife of the tigers after their physical extermination. In December 1941, the Japanese 25th Army invaded Malaya. Moving swiftly through the forest, they were savage, they were amphibious, they were able to move on land and water quickly, which surprised the British that were fighting them. And they were also known to be very savage and full of guile, full of treachery and tricks, you know. And so if you observe this, the way in which the Japanese troops were described, it actually resembled very much the qualities that the British projected onto the tiger kind of a century before that. Anyway, the Japanese 25th Army was led by General Tomoyuki Yamashita, who was actually widely known as the Tiger of Malaya. And Lieutenant General Takuma Nishimura, the second ranking officer, was also widely known as the other Tiger of Malaya. Well, the principal resistance in Malaya against the Japanese occupation was actually the Malayan People's Anti-Japanese Army, which was essentially a guerrilla organization under the leadership of the Malayan Communist Party. So when the Japanese forces surrendered in 1945 and was in the midst of leaving Malaya, We found that the name of the tiger or the usage of the tiger as a metaphor got transferred from the Japanese to these communist guerrillas. We see in public, in the press or in many discourses, the description of communist guerrillas as some kind of tigers. So, for example, when the first independent prime minister of Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, who only passed away last year, when he was describing his time of gaining independence with Singapore, in which he entered a short period of collaboration with the communists before he arrested them. After that, you know, he described the process as one of being, we knew we were riding on a tiger, you know. So very often you see these metaphors kind of returning. So in some sense, even with the physical sort of extermination of the tiger recurs as a metaphor incessantly, you know, in my parts of the world. So in any case, you know, as I mentioned, When the name of the tiger was transferred to the communists, the communists actually constituted now a very real threat to the British colonials who were returning after the war. Of course, they were weakened by the war, and the communist guerrillas in Singapore possessed basically weapons that they were using to fight the Japanese. But nevertheless, the communist guerrillas lost the struggle, and they eventually retreated from the cities into the forest, where they essentially they ended up taking shelter in the forest, which kind of in the Southeast Asian world, the forest is the shelter of myths and magic and animals. So in some sense, I think of the communists has kind of going back a certain kind of a full circle, becoming tigers. The British actually, to counter this new retreat of the Malayan communists into the forest, they began by intensifying the regulation of forested zones, offering cash bounties, organizing hunts and ambushes. And all of these were basically the same techniques that was used in the extermination of you know, tigers a century before. But sometimes, in the shadows of these dense tropical forests, the British hunters of communist guerrillas sometimes found themselves coming face to face with real tigers. Yeah. So this was also recorded in some memoirs of the soldiers, you know, who were involved in this operation. Yeah. So I guess with that, I would like to end this story of the tigers. Thank you.
It is my great pleasure to introduce Luis Jacob, artist, curator, and writer based in Toronto. As an artist, he's had several solo presentations in German institutions, so maybe known to a few of you as well, and perhaps particularly through his work shown at Documenta in 2012. And he's also curated several shows. I just mentioned the one that I've seen, Funk Aesthetics, in 2010 in the Justin Barnicke Gallery in Toronto. And I'd like to invite Luis Jacob to the stage. Form Follows Fiction, Cases of Mistaken Identity in Central Canadian Art. Thanks, Luis.
All right, let us begin with a poem. The Double Voice by Margaret Atwood. Two voices took turns using my eyes. One had manners, painted in watercolors, used hushed tones when speaking of mountains or Niagara Falls, composed uplifting verse, and expended sentiment upon the poor. The other voice had other knowledge, that men sweat always and drink often, that pigs are pigs, but must be eaten anyway, that unborn babies fester like wounds in the body, that there's nothing to be done about mosquitoes. One saw through my bleared and gradually bleaching eyes, red leaves, the rituals of seasons and rivers. The other found a dead dog, jubilant with maggots, half buried among the sweet peas. Margaret Atwood wrote The Double Voice as part of her cycle of poems titled The Journals of Susanna Moody, first published by Oxford University Press Canada in 1970. In that book, Atwood adopted the voice of Susanna Moody, an English woman who, in 1832, migrated to the British colony of Upper Canada, today the province of Ontario, where I live. Moody had written about her experiences as a settler in her two books, Roughing It in the Bush, or Life in Canada, published in 1852, and Life in the Clearings versus the Bush, published in the following year. At one level, Atwood's idea of the double voice suggests the divided worldview of the British settler in North America, trying to come to terms with a universe radically different from the one of her birth. Atwood once wrote that the Canadian pioneer is a square man in a round hole. He faces the problem of trying to fit a straight line into a curved space. From this perspective, the doubleness of the poem describes the split reality of painting watercolors while surrounded by mosquitoes. Moody's unsettled life in Upper Canada, unsettled to the extent that her life in the colony is lived in mismatched relation to expectations originating in the distant imperial center where she grew up. At another level, Atwood's double voice points to the dual utterance at play in the entire cycle of poems. In the book's afterword, she wrote, "I suppose many of these poems were suggested by Mrs. Moody's books, though it was not her conscious voice, but the other voice running like a counterpoint through her work that made the most impression on me." Atwood's voice as an author appears in an act of ventriloquism, projected through the voice of Susanna Moody, who was herself also an author. Atwood's poems are thus doubly inscribed. They emanate from the conscious, documented voice of a real historical figure from the 1850s, and they are imagined as that other contrapuntal voice of a fictional character of Atwood's creative interpretation. And I'm interested in the alternating presence in Atwood's poem of these two aspects of double voicing. So on the one hand, we have the split reality of the settler's life in the colony or periphery. And on the other hand, there is the double inscription in the act of authorial ventriloquism. In the first case, doubleness stems from the idea that Moody's new home, with its mountains and waterfalls, ought to be a splendid place for painting watercolors, were not for the fact that mosquitoes also live there. A place fails to coincide with the image that colonial desires assumes the landscape must conform to. To settle the land is to become unsettled by it. In the second case, doubleness arises from the idea that authors ought to develop their voices organically from the immediacy of their own practice. Were it not the case that an author like Atwood develops her voice artificially, a text is mediated through another author's text. And voice is a matter of playing with surrogates and impersonating them. Atwood's poetic insight lies, I believe, in the recognition of the rhythmic nature of this doubleness. Two voices took turns using my eyes. The Journals of Susanna Moody was published at a fertile moment of cultural nationalism in the literary scene of Toronto during the early 1970s. One of the institutional catalysts of this scene was the House of Anansi, a small press publisher of books that attempted to describe Canadian culture as seen from Toronto through an anti-imperialist lens. Margaret Atwood was a key contributor. In her book, Survival, A Thematic Guide to Canadian Literature, published by House of Anansi in 1972, Atwood returned to the writings of Susanna Moody and what she called her double-minded attitude towards Canada. Atwood framed Moody's writings in the context of aesthetic ideas of her time. Towards the middle of the 19th century, Atwood wrote, English immigrants were safely in Canada, their heads filled with diluted Burke and Wordsworth, encountering lots and lots of nature. If Wordsworth was right, Canada ought to have been the great good place. Complaining about the bogs and mosquitoes must have been like criticizing the authority of the Bible. According to Atwood, an imagination such as Moody's, filled as it was with Edmund Burke's and William Wordsworth's ideas on the sublime, would develop a conflicted relationship to the natural environment of her new home. The imagination would experience what Atwood described as a tension between what you were officially supposed to feel and what you actually encountered when you got there. She wrote, "In Roughing It in the Bush, Mrs. Moody's determination to preserve her Wordsworthian faith collides with the difficulty she has in doing so when nature fails time and time again to come through for her. Two emotions, faith in the Divine Mother and a feeling of hopeless imprisonment, follow each other on the pages of Moody's writings without break or explanation. Moody copes with the contradiction by dividing nature in two, reserving the splendid adjectives and the Divine Mother attributes for the half that she approves of and failing to account for the hostile activities of the other half. Again and again, we find her gazing at the sublime natural goings on in the misty distance, sunsets, mountains, spectacular views, only to be brought up short by disagreeable things in her immediate foreground, such as bugs, swamps, tree roots, and other immigrants." So, according to Atwood, Moody's double-minded attitude consists in this: a discrepancy between the unaccounted foreground of the world around her that is eclipsed by the splendid background of the world as projected to her from elsewhere. The projection tells Moody that her new home ought to take the form of the sublime in nature. But since the world she actually experiences fits this projection only intermittently, then she must leave outside of her written account the aspects of her experience that do not fit the picture. The result is a strange gestalt phenomenon, a conflicted figure-ground relationship. The ground, which normally contextualizes a figure and allows the figure to appear, the background now undermines the figure. We can even say, ironically, that the figure in Canada appears precisely in the event of being undermined. The foreground of the world where Moody lives remains unaccounted for in the conscious dimension of her writing. It can appear only in the form of an other voice, in another author's interpretive act of ventriloquism. Atwood's poem adopts and performs double-mindedness. Her writing embodies double-mindedness as something both to historicize and to reflect upon. So what does this strange gestalt look like to a Peruvian settler in Canada, such as myself, living in Toronto today in the early part of the 21st century? A few years ago, I had finished teaching a series of courses at the University of Toronto and the University of Guelph. As a sessional teacher, I was struck by how fascinated my students seemed to be by what they heard was happening in places like Berlin, London, and New York, and simultaneously by how very little they knew about what was happening in their own backyards. This predicament in the classroom reminded me of Penny Cousineau-Levine's book, Faking Death, Canadian Art Photography and the Canadian Imagination. In it, she described talking to her students at a photographic history course that she was teaching in Montreal, students who, as she noted, were themselves to become the next generation of Canadian photographers. She wrote, "When shown Canadian photographs alongside those made in Britain, the United States, and elsewhere, whether documentary photographs or portraits or landscapes, the almost universal response of these students was that they could see nothing in these images, that there was nothing there. The fact that these students had absolutely no sense of the significance of the products of their own people, and hence, by extrapolation of their own artistic work, that they could look forward only to making images they themselves would view as valueless and that would fall invisible into a critical void, all of this was enough to make me call into question what I was doing as a teacher." So her students, as well as my own, were inquisitive and invested in the work of fellow artists, but only as long as those artists represented people, places, and events that did not reflect the realities that these students experienced directly in their own lives. It seemed to me that for these students, reality was divided into the splendid background of images projected to them from the world's artistic capitals, and the unaccounted foreground of life around them. Foreground was eclipsed by background and could appear only as nothing in a case of mistaken identity. Real life was elsewhere. The foreground of bugs, swamps, tree roots, and other immigrants that we cannot account for seems to haunt us today, more than 150 years after Susanna Moody's time. This predicament of the split substitute reality of the imperialized imagination informs my curatorial work as an artist and my artistic work as a curator in Toronto. Let us begin then by supposing that this painting is in fact a theatrical stage set. It contains an arrangement of props for the kind of scenario that we have been calling a double-minded attitude. Like Velázquez's Las Meninas, it depicts an uncanny moment. The completed painting presents itself in the act of being painted. In order to do this, the artist has folded the composition in two, with each half subdivided again in two, creating a system of gaps and a network of reciprocities and correspondences that is complex to the point of vertigo. On the right-hand side, we observe two objects grouped together on a white wall. A shard of broken mirror catches the reflection of the painter, Fred Hagen, who looks intently at his own image. The broken mirror serves as support for displaying a memento, a clipped reproduction of the painting The West Wind of 1917 by Tom Thompson, an iconic work that is easily recognizable to lovers of Canadian art. So the right-hand side of the painting juxtaposes two kinds of images corresponding to two kinds of presence. The fleeting immediacy of the here and now reflection in the mirror and the mass media reproduction of an artwork from the National Canon of Art History. On the left-hand side of the painting, we witness a second instance of reflection and reproduction that reproduces and reflects the first one. The real canvas immediately before us in the museum makes a mise-en-abîme appearance inside itself as a projection of a painting within a painting. The second fictional canvas is propped on an easel in the artist's studio. It is surrounded by the stool on which the artist paints, his palette of still malleable pigments, a framed artwork displayed on the wall in a corner of the studio, and an assembly of completed works leaning one upon the other on the floor in an area of improvised storage behind the door. The fictional painting on the easel is accompanied, in other words, by figures representing the life cycle of the real painting. This life cycle constitutes the painting's own existence as a work of art, from raw artistic material in a state of potential to the blooming moment of exhibition and display, and finally to its fate and storage and possibly neglect, the critical void that Cousineau-Lévin warned us about. In Fred Hagen's Canadian painting of 1948, that fictional canvas on the easel is responsible for staging a tableau vivant in which the real canvas is implicated and enlisted to hold the pose of its own past and its own possible futures. These moments of the artwork's life cycle are negated, but never transcended by the painting's here and now presence before us in the museum. The mirror reflection appears less sharply in the fictional painting, less clearly defined than in the real one. The face in that mirror is suspended in a state of incipiency that is grotesque, like something unborn, or else is jubilant in its formlessness. And the clipped piece of paper appears there too in the fictional canvas, again supported by a fictional mirror on the wall. But the paper is now nearly blank. It depicts nothing, a blind eye or a vacant lot. That fictional piece of paper renders Thompson's own iconic artwork at a moment prior to its recruitment within the lineage of the National Artistic Canon. Its face, if we can call it that, is neither grotesque nor jubilant, but the absence that it registers is ambiguous. Its blankness, uninhabited like the new world of the colonial imagination, is both a kind of placeholder for experiences yet to be accounted for, as well as an erasure of things ignored and unrecognized. It is now worth taking a detour from Fred Hagen's Canadian painting to consider Tom Thompson's The West Wind, a painting that has accrued a very diverse body of discourse since the time of its creation 100 years ago in the shack of the studio building in Toronto. The 1990 catalog of the Art Gallery of Ontario's collection, of which the Thompson painting is an important part, had this to say. There are very few more widely recognizable and frequently reproduced icons of Canadian art than the West Wind. The artist, Lauren Harris, recalled in 1954 that he and Thompson had painted together in an old clearing at the south end of the Cochon Lakes, in the remote northeastern sector of Algonquin Park. Harris vividly described the violent spring thunderstorm that had whipped the dark blue-gray waters of the lake into sudden white caps. Tom and I took shelter in an abandoned lumber shack. Then Tom looked out, became excited by the drama of the scene, grabbed his sketchbox, ran out into the gale, squatted behind the big stump, and commenced to paint in a fury. So according to this description, the painting is the result of artistic fury aroused by a storm in Algonquin Park. More recently, David Silcox has described the painting in this way. The twisted trunk and branches show age and perseverance and bravery against the elements. The painting may also reflect Thompson's state of mind. He painted this canvas while in Europe, the First World War was raging, a cataclysmic event in which many of his friends were involved. So in this description, the painting continues to depict a storm, but this is as much a world historical storm as it is a natural one. Artistic fury is replaced by a metaphor of perseverance in the face of a war of empires, a European war in which Canada, then part of the British Empire, was necessarily embroiled. In 1974, Barry Lord again identified the theme of perseverance in the painting, but placed this theme on a different register. The tree in the wind is a symbol of the tenacious grasp on the land and on life that our nation has maintained. In the struggle to build our nation under the domination of a succession of the world's leading imperial powers, and he means those of France and England and the United States, we have had to dig in and hold on to become and remain who we are. This is clearly a national bourgeois symbol of our nation. To a class that is always being tempted to sell out, it represents the ideal of steadfastness. As an image of heroic endurance, therefore, the West Wind reflects both the aspirations and the limitations of the national bourgeoisie itself. In 1977, Harold Town and David Silcox once again identified the theme of heroic endurance, but this time they did so in order to deflate it. So they wrote, "It is our emblem tree, our token tree, and the question is why? First, because it is alone, and despite a paramount position in the composition formed as a commanding open arabesque, it allows an easy, faceted entry into the windswept distance. Thompson's pine gives us the comfort of a tree plus a sense of decoration. It is easily acquired firewood that we could knock down without much trouble. Not a giant redwood, 10 days work with an axe, but a magnified bonsai. The west wind reminds us of a day at the cottage that everyone dreads and how a pine like Thompson's makes it tolerable." Here, Lord's prior description of the struggle for survival against the comprador class that will sell out the nation's resources to the demands of empire is provocatively replaced by a bonsai tree, decorative and pleasing to look through. Both the Wordsworthian sublime and the myth of Canada's natural environment are rendered ironic by city dwellers for whom awe-inspiring nature is little more than a stormy day at the cottage. Today, the West Wind is on view in a special room at the Art Gallery of Ontario. The interpretive text on the walls contextualize its depiction of Algonquin Park in terms of national myths and contemporary First Nations land claims. The text reads, "This work has acquired iconic status over time, interpreted by many critics as a bold statement of national identity, resiliency, and belonging in nature. It is often used to reinforce ideas about Canadian identity and the Canadian landscape. For many, Algonquin Park embodies a pure and untouched ideal of wilderness. But even in Thompson's time, its landscape had been dramatically reshaped by colonialism, industry, and wildlife management. Large sections of the park had been clear-cut by the logging industry, and it was a popular tourist site easily accessible by rail. The park is also at the heart of a territory of deep significance to a number of First Nations, and land claim negotiations are ongoing today." I mean, this is amazing. I've never seen a museum actually contextualize an artwork in terms of contemporary First Nations land claims. It's quite astonishing and an amazing step for museum discourse in Canada. Today, the West Wind is displayed alongside Michael Belmore's Breadth of 2014. The sculpture is made of raku-fired clay and copper leaf, and depicts a young deer that has been run over by a vehicle. In North America, we would call this deer roadkill, a casualty of the violent encounter between the bush and the clearing. Exhibited together, the twisted body of the sculpture seems to correspond with the arabesque shapes of the painting. This curatorial gesture connects two artworks that were created a century apart, allowing each to take turns speaking through the other. The pose of the deer's body suggests a violent accident, but the lines of copper that fragment it indicate something else. The body has been carefully cut like a butchered animal or a landscape sectioned by property lines. These lines, which glow in the sculpture like the embers of an almost extinguished fire, have been traced in copper, an important mineral resource both for the Algonquin people of Lake Superior and for the colonial government. Today, the Algonquin people and the government of Ontario are engaged in a land claim negotiation over the Algonquin traditional territory, an area of over 9 million acres that includes Canada's national capital region, all of Renfrew County, and most of Algonquin Provincial Park, where the original sketch for the West Wind was painted. This body of discourse that orbits around Tom Thompson's artwork is condensed in the printed memento beside the mirror in Fred Hagen's painting. While Thompson's work has become an emblematic part of the national tradition, Hagen's own work is presently at risk of being forgotten. It is tempting, perhaps, to read the memento as an expression of Hagen's desire for inscription into the national artistic canon. In this context, we might detect in Canadian painting a story of canonical continuity. The temptation is real. In the beginning, we might hear it say, Canadian art was nothing but a blank canvas, since it lacked an autonomous artistic culture not beholden to European models. Then came Tom Thompson, an artist whose tragically brief but blazing career inspired a group of painters to develop a new artistic language for representing the distinctive features of the Canadian landscape. His work prepared the ground for future generations of artists who would further develop a truly national, no longer colonial, culture. This narrative, which begins in the clearing of cultural vacancy and ends in the cultivated garden, is the origin myth of the visual arts in English Canada. Like Maurice Denis's Hommage to Cézanne of 1900, so Fred Hagen's Canadian painting is plausible to us as an homage to Tom Thompson's seminal accomplishment and as a story devoted to the continuity of the national tradition. Such an interpretation is reasonable if we assume that Canada is a normal nation, like France, for example. But Canada is not a normal nation. As Menahem Blondheim observed in 2007, Canada represents a mirror image of the normal national state. Given its vast and fragmented expanse, it is a country divided by a common geography. Given its novelty and demographic heterogeneity, its unity is threatened rather than sustained by memory and history. These ideas are worth repeating. A common geography, normally what unites a country, is precisely what in Canada divides it. Memory and history, normally enlisted to sustain a sense of unity, serve in Canada to threaten unity. I know that these ideas are counterintuitive, and they are hard to digest, even where I live. Margaret Atwood once observed that Canada is an unknown territory for the people who live in it. Her efforts, as well as that of other authors associated with House of Anansi, challenged me to discern, within the painting's invocation of the nation, other voices running through it. To see a nation constituted as much by blank misrecognition as by identity, by erasure as by interpretive vertigo, by double-mindedness as by political projects of assimilation and unification. The project of assimilation does exist in Canada as elsewhere. It has created catastrophes, like the Canadian Indian residential school system, acknowledged by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission last year as a tool of cultural genocide that formally came to an end only in 1996, but whose consequences we live with today. Canadian painting invokes for me the work of other artists in the city of Toronto where I live, allowing these works to resonate across time. From Christian Flug's Interior at Night of 1965, with its two dolls looking out through an opening that is both transparent window and reflective mirror, to Joyce Wieland and Hollis Frampton's collaborative film A and B in Ontario of 1967, with its two artists, one Canadian, one from the US, mirroring each other with their film cameras in a game of hide and seek through the streets of Toronto. To Michael Snow's Authorization of 1969, with its time-warping sequence of photographs of a mirror taped to the self-same mirror brick by brick, eventually eclipsing the camera's reflection with photographs of photographs. To General Idea's double mirror video, A Borderline Case of 1971, with its group self-portrait presented as a dream of a community communicating with itself through its own self-mediation. And from Jeff Thomas's polyphonic ventriloquism in Culture Revolution, Toronto, Ontario, 1984, a photograph of the artist's son, Bear, who wears a baseball cap emblazoned with Edward Curtis's portrait from 1910 of the Cheyenne leader Two Moons. Edward Curtis's work is a source of so many contemporary stereotypes. As Bear poses for his dad's camera on Queen Street in Toronto. To Joanne Todd's The Magic of Sao Paulo of 1985, a painting that impersonates the front cover design of C magazine, preparing itself for reproduction in anticipation of its hoped for recruitment into the international biennial circuit. To John Sasaki's photograph, Microbes Swabbed from a Palette Used by Tom Thompson of 2012, a photograph perhaps of the bugs and swamps that live today in Thompson's artistic tools. To Rula Partenu's sculpture, Doppelkopf, of 2013, with its paired collection of facsimiles of office supplies, each side mirroring what is eclipsed in the other. Fred Hagen's painting allows me to connect these dots. It's quite plausible that in doing so, it sets the stage for a narrative of artistic lineage and canonical continuity. But I suspect that several elements in the painting disrupt this possibility. The brokenness of the mirror, the fold in the painting that engages and implicates the viewer, its play of figure-ground relationships, its embrace of both the jubilant and the grotesque, its palpable sense of orphanhood, and the fact that the meta-fictional painting depicted inside the fictional painting within the painting is rendered not as a blank canvas, not as a blank emptiness, but as an always already divided enigma at the heart of purported beginnings. Hagen's work is almost completely forgotten today, and it lies in wait in a critical void. It is perhaps for this reason that it dares me to imagine identities that are sustained by alternating between memory and oblivion, continuity and vertigo, authorship and ventriloquism, community and orphanhood, authenticity and stereotype, canon formation, and the hallucinatory refractions of mirror images and colliding projections. In the painting, I can glimpse a figure that, far from being grounded in unity, far from being undermined by rupture, is sustained in tension between these poles. We end at a perfect place to start by quoting from Northrop Frye's book, The Bush Garden, Essays on the Canadian Imagination, published by House of Anansi in 1971. He wrote, "The tension between the political sense of unity And the imaginative sense of locality is the essence of whatever the word Canadian means. I repeat, the word Canadian refers, for Fry, neither to a political sense of national unity, nor to a cultural sense of regional specificity, each place conceived in isolation. Canadian is what you get only in the tension that arises when different voices take turns using our eyes. Thanks.
I'm glad to introduce today's final presentation, about which I'm very excited, by Nida Ghouse and Malak Helmy, who together work under the title Emotional Architecture on the question of collaboration and what remains of the knowledge and shared experiences after they break up. I guess a kind of micro reflection on the larger question that already started to be addressed by Erhard Schüttpelz earlier on the question of shared experiences and literacy. A choreography for a burning house, Nida Ghouse and Malak Helmy.
I see you
and begin to mirror you.
The state sees us.
Sees us and begins to mirror us. It's almost 11 p.m. and a girl arrives for a drink. She steps out the elevator, walks past the bar and into open air. She looks around and then joins two guys sitting together at a table. She had expected only one of them, but then again, they both have exactly the same name. At some point, three turns into two once more. He takes his cue to step off stage, calls it a night, exits the frame. As she says, almost inadvertently, to the one who remains, "Won't you leave this city for a moment?" Something she could only do, for she had insufficient history and therefore little capacity to comprehend the implications of what tomorrow might bring. We started by calling it the summer of two fires and a landslide. The upper house of the parliament burned down and the main stage of the National Theatre went alight. On the outskirts, a rock face gave way to an avalanche of big boulders that buried people under their own homes. As the rescue operations closed, there was news of a passenger train that had burst into flames. It was on an outbound route, but for some reason, our memory is of it coming into the city ablaze. Why do we recall a spectacle that never happened, one which we had never seen? How does one tell an impossible story? I've asked myself for as long as I've remembered it by heart. But every time I sit down to it, meaning resists being written. Saying it out loud in confidence, I've learned is doable. A late night conversation between no more than two people, and they must be missed a crowd. Disguised in chatter, the story stood up on the table and danced itself in the dark. Took years before it even occurred to me to try it out that way.
Our talk today draws on work from and around our first publication. We started by calling it The Summer of Two Fires and a Landslide, of our project Emotional Architecture. And it takes its cue in part from Claire Davies' proposal for a dance choreography to be performed at the Royal Opera House, in which a woman coming to grips with the end of a relationship burns like a building. The publication was put together in 2013. It was concerned with notions of spontaneous combustion and material refusal in relation to the incineration of significant buildings in Cairo at various points in its history, particularly responding to a five-week period in August and September of 2008. It was a time during which we felt that animate and inanimate forms in the city began to shed and exchange their properties, performing the behavior of the other and possessing action and color at will. The particular historical context of this combustion was marked by the absence of a certain possibility of speech, and also a certain possibility of protest. the People's Assembly Archive in the Shura Council or the Upper House of Parliament, which could be thought of as the corridor of political decision making, and the National Theatre, or the site of spectacle, arguably one of the more prominent stages of cultural production in the region, both burnt down just weeks from each other. It was a time, which we'll talk about more later in this talk, of total contagion, seemingly orchestrated yet attributable to none. It was as if the mere anarchy of witnessing could cause an accidental, uncoordinated collective event.
Just to explain a bit more, the summer of 2008 came in the wake of an event that took place and is now colloquially referred to as April 6th, when a general strike, largely by Egyptian workers in the state-run textile industry in response to low wages and rising food costs. The protests took place in factories that were outside of Cairo in Mahalla. At the same time, in downtown Cairo, a protest organized by the left intelligentsia did not take place, as many of the main protagonists in this strike had already been arrested in the days running up to it. A demonstration was denied, and the streets were almost absolutely empty, a sight unseen in Cairo, save for policemen in plain clothes and a seasonal sandstorm that cast a haze across the day.
So, at a time when certain things that were being suppressed and could not actually be said or even imagined, other things stepped in to act from that space of speech, or perhaps in place of that speech, and in turn decided to protest. It was as if in response to that tension, that suffocation even, the airtight pressure built up by the forced denial of that speech and protest, that these prime state buildings could not but combust. They set themselves alight, and it was almost as if the matter of the state, official buildings, but also archives, decided to commit a kind of suicide.
In the event of the Upper House of Parliament burning, people gathered in the streets to watch a spectacle of state burning. Could this act of watching the heat of these bodies gathered in the streets, as they had done so before and would do so again, have initiated a possibility, an opening up of an imagination, which was not available before? Say, to imagine the end of a regime, the one that one was already watching, that then would slowly enter consciousness and speech and become a possibility. It was a fantastic fire. The building was old and largely made of wood. Fire engines from the station 5 minutes away took hours to arrive. A single helicopter could be seen scooping water from the Nile. People gathered there in the streets, not only not believing their eyes, but looking to the screens of phone cameras as if in confirmation.
If we were to follow this line of thinking, a flip occurs, wherein the allowance to begin to imagine the end of a regime is initiated by matter, a reversal even in so far as the logic of how things burn. In the Upper House of the Parliament, the fire started on the third floor, and then the building, the fire started to burn downwards, against the law, to the ground. Some of what we felt at that time and are doing and thinking through this event is in order to perhaps ask questions, questions to history, questions such as, what did that burning building know? What might it have been saying? What world was it opening itself up to? Because it did feel at that time that the act of self-immolation was an act of protest. In that sense, we have tried and are still trying to understand the language of fire, what was being said in that moment when certain things consumed themselves and ate themselves up.
The burning of these buildings can be thought of in relation to the notion of an electrical short circuit, which, at least in the case of 2008, was what the fires were attributed to. Insofar as the state's narrative, nothing much else was declared. An electrical short circuit, as per its definition, often results from the unintended contact of components and the consequent accidental diversion of a current. We can think about the notion of the short circuit in relation to three possible cinematic tropes. In popular cinema, short circuits are gateways to other dimensions, where by way of freak incidents, such as in Honey, I Blew Up the Kids or Back to the Future, we arrive at an opening to other possible worlds that are governed by different, often uncanny set of codes and rules. So an opening up to a world where something in this world may be unbelievable and unimaginable, but in that world is entirely possible. In the avant-garde cinema of 1920s, Eisenstein offers a theory of a montage of attractions in which he proposes that new meaning is generated in art through conflict and tension. He develops a method of producing images by placing singular details of two independent ideograms or semiotic units next to one another, letting them explode into something new. This collision into new meaning is made possible by an interval, a cut between one world and another. This dynamic confrontation is enabled by forces of attraction, compelled to attain a balance of contradiction, a process by which two elements make a third new compound and achieve chemical equilibrium in the process. In terms of the materiality of celluloid, which is highly inflammable in its composition, the possibility of combustion is already inherent in the object of cinema. So we can think not only about the image of something burning, but also about the burning of the image itself. On one hand, we have the act of seeing a fire captured in an image, and on the other, we watch the cinema itself burn, a fire started by a reel, a film that was set alight. We will keep this concise, but just to point to the scenes of the burning cinema in Inglourious Basterds, but also to the 26th of January, 1952, a day called Black Friday, when all of downtown Cairo was burnt down and 40 cinemas were set on fire.
So in thinking about this kind of collaboration between matter and meaning, we'll briefly introduce emotional architecture, a project we started sometime in 2012 in Cairo. It began as a series of conversations that were conceived as an exercise in addressing the social, intellectual, and psychic legacies of entering and leaving collaborations. We first began thinking about the idea of emotional architecture in relation to the notion of collaboration. A lot has been said and written about collaboration in the art context. These texts and talks are both reflexive in that they consider how collaborations operate within the art context, as well as expansive in that they extend to consider conditions of labor, of work in the world. A text that was influential for us was Florian Schneider's Notes on Collaborations, in which Schneider sets up a dichotomy, positioning the practice of collaboration in opposition to the more palpable notion of cooperation. The more provocative understanding of collaboration that he offers is of it as a brusque and ungenerous practice, what he calls the other side of a material labor. In collaboration, everyone may be working for their own self-interest. Everyone is in it for different reasons and therefore benefits from it in different ways. Collaboration, nonetheless, leads to all sorts of potentially precious outcomes. Part of that beauty of collaboration is that everybody's work points to someone else's, such that there is no clear authorship. Also in a collaboration, a person can benefit another by passing on knowledge that she herself does not possess.
We started to think about the fact that there's not much said about the emotional register of collaboration, of what forms, sustains, supports, and props up collaboration. What is its infrastructure or architecture? How does power operate within it? In thinking through a range of situations, from minor artist collectives and temporary social movements to grand historical narratives, we began by asking what happens to knowledge that was born in collaboration when collaborations break up, which often they do. So grand narratives in the sense of asking how does one break up with history, or with the canon, we might say. We talked together with friends about how certain dynamics of power become apparent like a ghost of an underlying governing structure, but only in moments of emotional involvement and heightened awareness in which a threshold has been breached. We wanted to articulate what it is that comes to be known in these encounters with one's own ideological or physiological limits, specifically in relation to collective contexts in which the soul is at work. We tried to contain these events in language, and for our second publication, No Fantasy Without Protest, we commissioned our collaborators, Muataz Atalla, Lina Atalla, and Philip Risk, to write as much as possible from the edges of their interdiscipline: journalism, activism, filmmaking, education, comedy, philosophy, anthropology, and art history. What we found instead was that meaning breaks down and that it grows harder to speak with conviction when one no longer inhabits those conditions and can no longer see the apparition. Our engagement with these concerns happened to have developed at a particular political disjunction during which the ground of our analysis kept moving and the rules no longer applied. So what are the social, intellectual, and psychic legacies of entering and leaving collaborations? This is not so much a question of what one claims after collaboration, insofar as an ownership of ideas, but rather of how one survives them. And perhaps more importantly, looked at the other way, what is it that survives collaboration? What is it that remains as residue or as excess? What is it the thing that surpasses the end of collaboration?
Keyword Searches for Habit is a video that was composed in 2009 in response to an invitation to an exhibition titled Invisible Presence in Cairo. It is structured around translating the Arabic word habit into English, producing the terms dust, aerosol, as in suspended liquids and gas that have an explosive quality, vanity, as in mirroring, and chaos, as in the condition caused by the inimitable loss of information. Habit is generally defined in Arabic also as the moment when one sees individual particles of dust suspended in the air, particles that are rarely visible to the naked eye, that are seen only in a particular quality of light that has the capacity to draw these suspended particles into focus. It is also a term used in idioms in Arabic to express the moment when all meaning is lost, and at other times when everything goes up in flames. I took this image of the site of a forthcoming exhibition on the 20th of July at 10:02 to scope the ground for a production. The following shots were taken of this and this and this. In the fourth image was the shadow of a man in the right third of a room. He did not look at me and swept for 4 minutes in a square of 3 meters. The dust did not move, he swept silence. Sound billowed from around him, producing beige stillness in the air, broken by slithering pixels of habit around himself. While scanning the image's edges, I noticed the room carried calcified dunes in its corner pockets, dunes that this man could not seem to sweep away. Leaning gently seaward and leeward, a carved arch like that between the lower back and the tailbone, a curve like the cheek from the ads of that perfume. So then I got in there and bent my knees, lowered my thighs, leaned my weight, to get near enough for smelling distance, to see closely a hazed edge, out of focus, a crest, moving ever so slightly, going somewhere else, grain by grain. And as the dune moved, I trailed it as it tried to sneak itself away. The sweeping man said, "The building is ill. It's been sloughing, it's shedding its own skin." And then I left, and this is the last that I saw of the site and the exhibition that never took place. I took this image on the side of a window on the 30th of August at 12 noon to scope particles of dust in the lungs of a chamber that lead me into the city. The following shots I took were of this and this and this. In the 10th image was the face of a mannequin in the left third of the room that for 3 years shed 70 to 80,000 skin cells a day, crumbling outer layers to produce an unfocused edge, shedding flakes, diamond pixel tiles around herself. I took her to a doctor to inquire why a mannequin would be inducing its own destruction. He got up close to smelling distance, crouched his thighs, traced and tracked the fabric of her plastic limbs, and focused closely on her blurred edge. Prodded into the absent sections, chunks of her have moved away, he said, tile by tile. He said she was ill, looked at me suspicious and asked who started it. I said I didn't know which of us was the source of the shedding. He said one of us dropped a sequence from the verses of our skin, and as a mirror the other translated, another sequence lost, then was reflected back, an absent response, then transferred forth, an absence produced, and so on, a sequence, or lack thereof, mutated by empathetic exchange. He could not say what was absent and what was produced, what was cast and what was amassing, but he was getting ill by overwatching. The issue, he said, was this empathetic contagion, the potential of an epidemic, of collective enactment by overviewing. I took this video from the site of an unknown location on the night of the 30th of August at 11:02 to scope the possibility of personification, the possibility of reflexive symptoms, like the light from fireflies that spontaneously pulse in response to each call until they all pulse in rhythm, like this, and this, and this. To make 100 volts of luciferase is one sheet of white light. The doctor used this to test my DNA, injected me with the glow of fireflies that would lodge themselves in holes in skin where mine or the mannequin's sequence had flaked off. The absence, he said, is transferable, fillable, illuminable. They tracked me with black light, but my pulses were silent. They tracked her with black light and saw the holes where things were missing. They watched them glow as luciferase seeped into skin cells that cast off as fluorescent dust. On the mornings of the month of September, I took the dust from the site of her body to scope the city for whirlwinds and found images of this and this and this. The doctor and I blew it into the air to trace pulses with pink markers under black lights. I began to see cars on a highway that would signal back and forth while approaching a predator or a lover. A little off at first, flickering, until it became one synced sheet beating, but as it reflected back and forth, it overproduced light, and the dark fell out of the sequence. There was no dark. All glowed like an unstoppable fire, with sparkling diamond-cut reflections, slithering glossy pixels underneath. But then the pulsing stopped, and it became one single tone, like one organismic sheet of brilliant white light. Then the doctor told me, "You know, fireflies no longer exist. They died long ago with the darkness. But we extracted their luciferase and we use it to trace a trail of images to produce each other and produce seizures."
Scientifically speaking, a mirror neuron is a neuron that fires both when an animal acts and when the animal observes the same action being performed by another. The neuron mirrors the behavior of the other as though the observer itself was acting, as an intimate muscle or atomic memory. It is by this process that we largely learn and develop motor actions. Mirror neurons are the neural basis of the human capacity for emotions such as empathy. It is in many ways that the body confuses the act of having seen something as the act of having done it, learning as a means of feeling for others. It's an act of literal embodiment through witnessing, of being both the other and the self at once.
It was during that event that we keep referring to that we came to be interested in the notion of empathetic exchange, or in the possibility of reflexive symptoms between different kinds of matter under duress. In conditions of extreme pressure, something shifted, such that emotional communication between different kinds of formal and chemical compositions, say a human and a building, became possible. These agents were no longer separated by their different ontologies. The act of mutual witnessing enabled a metonymy to exist between these different bodies, a contagion of qualities and behaviors. And when we say that these things happen, we're not saying it as a poetic device. Perhaps through a particular lens, it would be called a kind of psychosis, such that it appears to be a symptom of schizophrenia or mania, when one can disassociate from oneself and associate with others or other beings. Taken to an extreme, one confuses or even refuses any separation between oneself and everything else. One reads and feels everything together at once, insists on the memory of an experience they may not have had. But perhaps it was not psychosis either, at least not exactly. Rather, we were at the brink of another paradigm in which we could sense the burning building in relation to a larger context of events and non-events. This also changed the terms of what was possible in language as well, such that we could say that the building was in protest. Here, let me do it. Mm-mm.
speaking through another voice.
How about this?
And there you go. Oh. All done.
Okay.
A woman is having a conversation on a phone. She is a painter, and her lover is a young woman named Dahlia, who is also her muse. She has just learned that Dahlia is engaged to be married. She pleads with her on the phone, then, finding no way through, hangs up and has a breakdown. This is the first paragraph of Claire Davies' text, Cairo Variety Show, which opens with a proposal for a dance choreography to be performed at the Royal Opera House, which burnt down under mysterious circumstances in 1971 on its 100-year anniversary of the opening opera, Verdi's Aida, for which it was made. In her text, Claire looks at two scenes from a breakdown at the end of a film called Gunul and Shabab, or Madness of Youth. The scenes appear in her text in the form of a sequence of photographs of the original film shot on automatic at half-second intervals. She attempts to break down the scenes of this breakdown to substitute the emotional charge and the charismatic appeal of the moving image, its narrative momentum, as well as its melodrama, with a dispassionate photographic study of motion to reduce it down to movement.
She outlines a series of phrases of a choreography. Touches her mouth, loose fingers, loose like they are forgotten. Turns slightly, three quarters. Collapsing chest vault, contracting face. Glance at the floor, turn to profile hands hang. Head back, throat open, knees folding, hands on knees, prayer-like. Folding knees, waist, neck. Kneeling, chest caving continues. Head giving way, screaming, moments of acceptance, another pillar collapse, surrender, supplication, feel for support, hands to floor, breathe, carried by the heat, curve upwards, slight blow from the left, head turn right, hands pause caving again from the waist, head drops almost to the floor, settling here, shaking head, disbelief, sensing someone's approach.
What is Claire doing and why? What is this impulse to produce a dispassionate dance? What is driving the decision to try and fail to strip these phrases that describe the movement of the body, to strip them of excessive expression and melodrama? And what does it mean to take such a position in moments of political upheaval and emotional excess? In Claire's work, but also in the work of many others who've come before her. We're thinking of Yvonne Rainer and, in a different way, Valeska Gert, among others. We were interested in how this impulse was historically constituted. What was inscribed in this aesthetic of indifference, or also an act of madness that was, in a way of keeping from going mad?
In the preface of our second publication, No Fantasy Without Protest, which we printed last October, we wrote, and now in retrospect, we're posing these same questions to Claire, to what Claire wrote in 2013. How do we translate events of psychological violence and lexical transgression? Can we reposition unstable desires into language without arresting them? What is it to interpret these conditions as they register on a corporeal level, at the scale of the individual, and also in relation to the fragmentation, reconfiguration, or dissolution of a group. Wavering ideologies and shifting allegiances meant that what was known to those who had been there then was something they were no longer bearing witness to. Our task was not just to translate words and images, but emotional and psychological transformation, changes in interior composition. How do we transcribe the experience of intolerable complexity onto a textual plane? Ultimately, this is what we found ourselves faced with.
We were working at a time where Cairo was a place with coordinates in flux, and we were all subject to the weather of events. Even though our project, Emotional Architecture, was not envisioned as a project for writing about what happened, and was rather committed to writing itself, the distinctions between these intentions was impossible to maintain. Language was a frontier, and it was closing in. Even if we did not know how to say what we wanted to say, nor to what end, the compulsion to sustain a community of thought through the process of writing together was what drew us along. 2 years on, these texts have been a long time coming.
Should I switch
here? Yeah.
Okay. We had wanted to find a locational language, a language that one might not know they already have, to stand on ground from which the shape of yet unknown desires could manifest. But how does one record the memory of an image of a future that will not be, when transcription and translation turn against themselves? We knew we had to try to keep the past from slipping, to reclaim the moment even as it was being rewritten. If on the outset we were oriented towards the poetics of protest, what we came to learn was what was at stake was much more basic. The site to occupy was that of clarity, an unbearable clarity from which fantasy can begin to exist again.
Thank you.
Thank you.